Hey everybody, today I am going to be painting this painting of Howl from Howl's Moving Castle in the outfit that Harry Styles wore to the Met Gala. So when I first saw the picture of Harry Styles, I was intrigued, to say the least, by the outfit. It was very much, you know, one of those outfits that has like a lot of texture, a lot of, you know, variation, a lot of good highlights and lowlights and stuff like that. And it was very pretty, and it immediately reminded me of Howl because, I mean, the man that says, "What's the point in living if I can't be beautiful?" Come on. So that's what I decided to paint today. And I actually worked on this piece over the course of a couple of days. I think it was 3 or 4 to be exact. So you might see a lot of cutting between the days and everything like that. I tried to edit it the best that I could in, you know, a pleasing way to look at, because, you know, that's what you do on YouTube, right? But yeah. Anyway, I just kind of wanted to start sharing my process of painting and everything like that, you know, with other people on the internet who might, you know, just kind of want to see my process, or maybe you can learn something from me. I don't know, but I just thought it might be fun, you know, to kind of do. So, as you see right now, I'm kind of working on his skin tone. I have, you know, a regular skin tone kind of color, and I have a little bit of a more pinky color that you can kind of see there on my palette. And I like to switch between the two. I actually got this trick from imawonder here on YouTube and Instagram and everything. I think all of her handles are imawonder, but I'll link her down below. She was actually the first person that I saw do this, and I thought that it was really cool because, you know, as she says, it kind of starts putting in that dimension in the skin tone automatically without you having to really go in and like render anything. And it also just looks really pleasing to me, especially, you know, with the use of watercolor, the colors like to kind of blend together and everything. And it's just really nice to look at least in my opinion. So, you know, I decided to start doing it too, and I really, really like it. I think this is actually the first piece that I tried it out on, but I will definitely be taking that as a tool that I will use going forward. Especially because, like, by the end of the piece, you can kind of see how much of a difference it makes. I'll maybe put a couple of different pieces of my art from before where I wasn't doing this, just so you can kind of see the difference in when you do it and when you don't. But I went ahead and mixed a little bit of a black that I went in with on the outfit. It's mainly just a couple little tiny dips of black watercolor and some water, but I did add a little bit of purple that you can kind of see there on the palette on the other side, and just kind of let it mix in together gradually throughout the process of painting. And it did definitely like do a lot for the dimension of the outfit, I think, especially when it comes to like the ruffles and everything. This is definitely a piece that was kind of difficult for me because there was a lot going on with the outfit. I mean, there's transparent parts on the arms, there's ruffles, there's lace, there's a lot of different detail. And I think that sometimes I get a little bit overzealous with my artwork, and I love the detail work. So I love to, you know, make a piece with that in mind, with like doing a bunch of detail work. But then it's also so tedious. Like, if you do art yourself, you'll know it can take so long to kind of, you know, get all those details in the way that you want them. And honestly, sometimes you get tired of working on a piece before you get all of the details in, which I'm not gonna lie, I might have done with this piece. Please don't, you know, blame me for that. I literally worked on this piece for like 4 days straight. Not straight, I'll say, because I do wait for my painting to dry naturally. I don't use like a hair dryer or anything like that to kind of speed up the drying process. But yeah, other than like the drying between layers and everything like that, I did work on this piece for about 3 or 4 days straight. I can't remember exactly, but, now I'm just kind of going in, deepening that, purple that I decided to use on the outfit instead of the black, just because, especially with the piece, you know, it's Howl. I wanted him to be, you know, kind of in that, you know, that space that everyone thinks of when they think of Howl's Moving Castle, you know, all the clouds and the mountains and, you know, the little river areas or like little lakes or whatever they are, and you know, the grass and the flowers and everything. I did end up not doing the flowers by the end of it, just because I had been looking at this piece way too long and just wanted to kind of, you know, move on to something new. But I think maybe in the future, you know, if I have time, I might do that. And right here I'm starting to, well, I've been doing it for a couple minutes, but I'm just kind of deepening up the areas that I would want to deepen up for like shadows and everything. This is just kind of a start of doing that. So yeah, that's what I'm doing right now. I think that something that I forget a lot, especially with pieces like this that have like a lot of layering with fabrics and stuff like that, I kind of try to wing it, and maybe I shouldn't do that as much, because as you'll see later on, I actually go through and cover the area on the chest underneath the ruffles. I cover it with a thin layer of that purpley color to kind of give it a little bit more of an opaque look, especially because I knew I was going to be going in and doing the lace detailing there as well. But I did kind of want it to still, I wanted it to blend with the rest of the outfit, but I also kind of wanted it to stand out. And I don't know, I guess I, especially while I'm working on a piece, like sometimes I'll just sit there for hours looking at it, like not moving, not doing anything else. And I think that I kind of get in this habit of doing things without really thinking them through too much. And not to say that I think that this piece turned out bad or anything, I actually really love it, but this piece definitely made me think about that a little bit more, especially because I haven't painted in a while. I have been working a lot with markers and my sketchbook and stuff like that, but I haven't actually picked up paint in about a month at this point, before I did this painting. So I was kind of trying to get reacquainted with watercolor and like how I like to use it, at the same time that I was trying to do techniques that I had barely used in watercolor, if ever. So it definitely was like a little bit of a learning process and a little bit of a process in general, but again, I really did like how it turned out. Right now I'm going in and deepening the ruffles, the areas where there would be some darkness and everything, and kind of doing a little bit of like a bunch up at the top where the neckline is. I did end up going and covering that area, so that's not something you can really see in the finished piece. But like, that's kind of what I'm meaning though, like the whole idea of I really try to do things kind of like on a whim, but maybe I need to think a little bit more, because I did that whole neckline and everything, all the details, all of that good stuff right around the shoulders and everything, and then later on in the piece I go and cover it up with his hair. So yeah, I definitely still like it, like I've said a million times, but I definitely think, like, especially now that I'm recording it, I'm really seeing the kind of things that I would like to improve on myself. So maybe you guys are in the same boat, and this will help you realize that you're doing it too. And if you want to change it, you can. And if you love doing it that way, that's cool too. Art is art. Art is what we want it to be, and art is how we like to do it, because at the end of the day, we do it for fun. We do it because we love it, and we do it because it makes us happy. So yeah. This idea of having a bunch of textures and like stuff with outfits, I feel like is something I've been doing a lot recently in paintings. I'll put a little bit of a clip here of my last piece, Surrender. The angels in the piece also have translucent sleeves on their outfits as well. And the piece The Giver that I did of my girlfriend Jocelyn is another piece that uses that transparent cloth texture. I kind of tried to make it look like it was the strawberry dress, but if it was cowrie shell dress instead, just because cowrie shells are one of her favorite shells, so I figured I would, you know, try to tie that in some way. But yeah, and it's been a lot of fun kind of working and trying to get the textures and everything right with transparent material. It's definitely a little bit of a struggle. Like, I think even though I've been doing it a lot recently, I feel like the reason I've been doing it a lot is because I really want to, you know, I want to hone that skill and I want to get really good at it, because when you can do stuff like that really well, it turns out so nice and so beautiful, and it's just really cool to look at, and I would really love to be able to do it in such a way that like looks really, really good. Like that, like, I definitely still think this looks good, but I don't know, I can see where I have room to improve. So I think I'm gonna step a little bit away from talking about my painting process and stuff like that, and just kind of, you know, start talking about the fandom aspect, because that's something I definitely wanted to do with this video. I mean, especially because it is a fan art at the end of the day. So if you don't know who Howl is, he is one of the characters from Howl's Moving Castle. He is a magician. He's very beautiful. You know, he's the pretty boy that we all love. He very much reminds me of Tamaki sometimes, but like if, like Tamaki from Oran High School Host Club, but like with a little bit, I feel like by the end of the movie, he has a little bit more of a level head compared to Tamaki, or maybe most of the movie, I don't know. I just get the vibes, you know, but he was definitely one of my first anime crushes for sure. And, you know, with the beginning of quarantine and everyone, you know, going back to their childhood favorites, I decided to show my girlfriend Howl's Moving Castle, because she actually has never seen any Ghibli movies before that. And that was, like, something I needed to change immediately, because I absolutely love the Ghibli films. They're amazing. But I started with Howl's Moving Castle for her because it's, again, it's like my favorite one ever. Just like I feel like I've always been able to connect to Howl's Moving Castle in a way that I haven't been able to connect to the other movies, just because like Sophie being turned into an old woman, I feel that. I feel like an old person, and I feel like I have constantly felt like an old person throughout my life. So it was kind of cool to, you know, see someone, you know, who was young kind of go through that like transformation, and like how easily she just kind of, you know, gets into it and is like, yeah, I can be an old lady, whatever. I mean, she basically was just doing the stuff she was doing before, but it's fun to see that kind of like a I'm young but I don't like doing things that people my age like to do rep, because I'm definitely in that boat. Like, for instance, like, I'm 23, I've never been to a club before, stuff like that. Like, I like to read and I like to watch anime, which I guess that's the only thing that I would say probably a lot of old women don't watch anime, but whatever. Yeah, it's nice to see that kind of a rep, especially, now that I feel like a lot of things that you see on TV, like even if it's aimed towards younger audiences, it's still very much that like, let's go party, la la la. Which, not to say that's bad. I don't think that's bad at all. I mean, I think if you're doing something and you're having fun and you're not harming anyone, that's cool. But it's just not my cup of tea specifically, and that is also okay. So I'm gonna jump back into the painting a little bit more. Right now I'm starting to work on the water for part of the background. And I did wanna kind of keep the background a little bit more minimal, just because I knew for a fact I was gonna be doing a ton of detail work on Howl himself, and he was like, you know, the main subject of the piece. So I was like, all right, let's just kind of keep the background a little more chill, a little more minimal, which I think is also something that I tend to do a lot with my paintings. I make my subject very detailed, very like, not hard line work all the time, but like very much like you're gonna see some line work, because I love line work and I cannot get away from it for the life of me. It's one of the first things that I started doing was just strictly line art, and then I started incorporating color way longer after I started doing art. I think because I started doing art when I was in elementary school, and it was mainly just like anime and stuff like that. So I would do line art of, you know, characters and stuff like that, and I wouldn't color it in. So very much like it looked a lot like manga, because, you know, it was anime style, but just black and white. It didn't have all the like hatching and stuff like that that manga typically does, but kind of sort of reminiscent of it in a way. But yeah, that's kind of how I started. So it's very difficult for me to get away from doing line work, even if it's something that I don't necessarily want to do in a piece, just because I'm so used to doing it, and it just comes so naturally to me at this point, because I've done it literally throughout my entire art journey slash career slash whatever you want to call it. So yeah, there's gonna be line work, and yeah, I forgot where I was going with that, but I don't know, here we are. So I started doing the mountains in the back now. You kind of can't see what I'm doing on that one side just because of the way that the camera is. And I do promise I will get better with that. I honestly didn't look at the footage too much before going into edit or anything like that. I kind of was just like, I set up my tripod, made sure that most of the painting was on the screen at least, and then just went for it. So I'm gonna try to get better with that throughout time, and like kind of figure out what exactly the setup I want to have is, and like all of that good stuff, because I definitely do want to have enough space to for you guys to be able to see like the products that I'm using and everything, which, by the way, I will have all the products that I use linked down below, or at least mentioned down below. And you can kind of see a little bit of them in the first shot, the little glamour shot of the painting, you can see them there. And I have that again at the end of the video, so you can see them there too. Hey, so sorry about the cut in the audio there. Some of my neighbors got home, so my dog started to bark a whole bunch, and I didn't want any of you, especially if you have headphones in, to hear that, you know, right in your ears like that. So I just went ahead and cut that part of the audio out and started like a new recording. But something that I wanted to go ahead and mention in this video is that our shop, Shells and Shrooms, is going to be doing a monthly donation every single month, obviously, because it's a monthly donation, but basically we will be taking 20% of our proceeds. Sorry. Sometimes I stumble over my words and it sucks, but it happens. Anyway, 20% of our proceeds, or our revenue for the month, will be donated to a specific nonprofit or GoFundMes for people in need and stuff like that. So this month is going to be Black Period Project, which is a North Carolina-based youth-led nonprofit organization that seeks to educate the community about period poverty, Lord, empower young girls and trans boys to feel normal and confident about their cycle, and work to end gaps of access to period products for the Black community of North Carolina. Some of their past work has been in menstrual hygiene supply drives. They've done packaging parties for basically like packs of period products and stuff like that, that they will then go and distribute to people in need. They have had petition parties to petition the end of the pink tax in NC, a bunch of stuff like that that's just absolutely amazing. So if you would like to support and donate to Black Period Project directly, you can go to their Instagram, Which has links for their Cash App and their PayPal, which you can donate to directly, which that is usually going to go to getting supplies that they need for those packages that I was telling you about that they would do with the packaging parties and stuff that they would then go and distribute. But they also will take donations of pads, tampons, liners, boxers, panties, cleaning wipes, baby wipes, composition notebooks, pens, and markers. And I'll go ahead and put down below the address that you can directly mail those to if that's something that you're interested in as well. And again, we will be donating 20% of our revenue to that. So if you wanted to go ahead and visit our shop and see if there's anything there that, you know, you like, you could get a nice piece of homemade art or a nice piece of homemade jewelry and also support a good cause at the same time. So yeah, I just thought I'd let you guys know about that. And I'll be keeping you guys updated on that going forward, either through, well, I'll definitely mention it in our videos and everything like that. But if you wanna keep more up to date, just go ahead and follow our Instagram and Twitter and you'll get more updates about that, you know, as we get there and as time goes on and whenever I post. So yeah. Now I'm kind of going in a little bit with, you know, some watercolor markers, which are the markers that I was telling you about that I was kind of working with before. I don't know. I guess just, I'm trying to do a little bit more of the line work right there just because, you know, it, needs it. At least to me, I feel like a lot of times when I'm trying to kind of figure out what I really want to do with a piece, especially at like this kind of point where I have like most of the colors and most of the rendering mapped out, like it's really kind of hard for me to figure out how to proceed without at least a little bit of line work in there. Especially because, you know, that's kind of how I started off, was just doing straight up line work. And I didn't really incorporate color into my art until a lot longer after I started doing art in general. Yeah, just kind of working on that. So something else that I kind of wanted to talk about is the kind of idea that, like, sometimes things, I don't really know how I want to put this. I guess that idea of, like, when you're younger, you have something that, like, you really love doing and, like, is really cool to you and everything like that, and it's like your thing, but then, like, you go outside of your household or, like, wherever, and, you know, you do that, and then people start to judge you for it or tell you to stop because it's weird or whatever. I feel like I've been feeling kind of the pressure to stop doing things like that a lot in my life, but especially recently, especially with, like, quarantine and everything like that starting, I've kind of just learned to not do that and not stifle my joy and my happiness. And I kind of coined a term for it. I like to call it aggressive joy, because it's almost kind of like, It's like this idea that like you're following like what makes you happy and what you like, whether anyone else thinks it's cringy or weird or like whatever. It brings you happiness, so you continue to do it, and you're not like harming, and I mean this is for like things that like you're not hurting anyone when you're doing, obviously, and stuff like that, like things that are good for you. But yeah, I like to call it aggressive joy, and that's something that I kind of wanted to share with you guys, and it's something that I really want to bring into this channel in general, just and that's why I'm mentioning it in the first video after all. I want to inspire people through my artwork to kind of let go of like adhering to those social norms of like feeling like you have to do things a certain way or whatever. Because I mean, at the end of the day, like, who says you have to do it that one specific way? And who says this thing is cringy and like why is it cringy and like all of those things? Like, if you love it, it really truly does not matter, as long as you are not harming anyone. And all of that is to say, like, a lot of my artwork will probably be stuff that, like, you know, is very personal to me and is makes me very happy. Like, for instance, I love this movie. It is my favorite movie, so I'm doing a fan art of it. And I have a couple other videos that are gonna be fan art as well. So there's probably gonna be a lot of fan art and a lot of, you know, my own stuff kind of like intertwined together on this channel. And I do kind of want to do, I do wanna have like videos where it's not strictly just art either, like, you know, videos with like me sitting down and kind of like talking about like, I don't know, maybe like the packaging process that I have for my shop and like how I pack my orders and like do that, or studio vlogs and stuff like that. So it definitely will be a more art focused channel, but I just kind of wanted to let you guys know going into it kind of what the plan is and like what I want to do. And I definitely am open to suggestions for like not only just what kind of content you would like to see from me, but I also really, 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 really love input about different like art that you want to see, like art specific things. Like, if you want to see a specific character and you want me to do fan art of them, please let me know. If you like have recommendations for shows that you like, please let me know. And you know, I'm probably gonna be doing the same, because you know, I'm just trying to fill time of me drawing or painting or whatever on screen, so I'm probably just gonna talk about whatever pops in my head. But yeah, definitely, like, if you guys have suggestions, let me know. I'll let y'all know what my suggestions are. Yeah. For instance, like, I'm trying to learn Spanish because I am, Puerto Rican, but I did not learn Spanish growing up. Both of my brothers did, but I did not. So I'm trying to kind of catch up on that now as an adult. But, I've been watching, this show on Netflix called Las Chicas del Cable. See, I'm still learning. I'm still getting used to it. So please bear with me. But, yeah, it's, I feel like I've definitely gotten a lot more confident in speaking Spanish after watching that show. But I also, just think it is a great show. It is about these, telephone operators during the 20s and 30s, women's rights revolution, that kind of a thing in Spain, Madrid specifically. And it's so good. Like, it's just so good. Like, it's definitely one of those stereotypical kind of, you know, like novelas, but it's so good. It's so addicting. And I'm pretty sure I've watched the entire series in over the course of a week, which is really surprising because each episode's like an hour long and there are like six seasons, but it's very, very, very good. And it definitely sucks you in. Like, you definitely, like, you love those characters. Like, you get to know them and you get to love them. But yeah, so that's a good one. I've also been watching Demon Slayer because, duh, everyone's been watching Demon Slayer if they haven't. But it's so good. I'm about to be done with the first season. So yeah. And then I was gonna say, I don't even know if they have a second season out right now. Let me actually go ahead and check that, because if not, I'm gonna go crazy. So let me see. Also, please ignore the typing and stuff like that, because truly, I'm just sitting here watching my painting and talking over it because I have literally nothing else to do at this point, except for make this voiceover and finish it. So I'm just trying to do that, and I feel like I'm running out of topics. So yeah, I'm using the Sakura Micron pens. I'm pretty sure everyone and their mother has used those at this point, but they are some of my favorites, especially because they are water resistant. Most of the time when I make a piece, I would go in, do my sketch, use my Sakura Microns, and then go in with paint over top of it. And then if I needed to like touch up the line work afterwards, that's what I would do. But yeah, I don't know. I just, for some reason, didn't do that with this piece. I just kind of wanted to try out doing it the opposite, not opposite way, but like, well, yeah, it's the opposite from what I normally do it, but it's not like, you don't have to do it a specific way, you know? So like, I don't know, if you don't do it that way, that's perfectly fine. But yeah, I guess just trying new things and stuff like that. I'm definitely trying to do more with my art, I guess. So that's just kind of where I'm at, just trying to figure that out. And now I'm doing the lace detailing, which I really didn't know what I was doing with. I was just kind of like trying to get it done. But I feel like I definitely could have done a lot better, especially if I had pulled up a reference of lace, but I did not because I was tired. So I will learn from that, or maybe I won't, because I feel like consistently towards the end of a project, when I get tired, I just stop looking at references for things and just start doing things and hoping it looks good willy-nilly. Which goes back into the, I should probably, you know, plan out what I'm doing a little bit more, but, you know, we live and we learn, we do what we do. So, yeah. And then, I kind of wish I had left it the way it was here with, like, the little flowers and everything, but I absolutely did not. And again, that's one of those things, you live and you learn and you figure out what you like and what you don't like, and you don't make the same mistakes. Or maybe you do, because sometimes it takes a little bit to learn, but that's fine. But anyway, yeah, this is pretty much all I did for the piece. I hope that you guys like it. I hope that you guys have enjoyed kind of watching my process and all of that good stuff. And I hope that you guys, you know, stick around, because this is definitely not going to be the last one. But yeah, anyway, thank you guys so much for hanging out with me today and, you know, even checking this out to begin with. It means a lot for sure. And yeah. If you wanted to check out any of our socials, they're right here on screen, or I'll put them down in the description box as well. And if you would like to subscribe, please do so. If you would like this video, like it if you liked it, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And thanks.